It's an opportunity for us to review what we have achieved, for me to say a few words why I think it's just so important, but also to join Karen and thank you, say thank you to a number of people. First of all, I want to start by acknowledging the minister's interest and commitment and effective support for CYP IAPT, and also the Department of Health, where the children and young people IAPT team have worked tirelessly and inspirationally, but also the adult IAPT team that have supported us. There are actually a large number of people who have contributed that we could not find pictures of on the internet. Kevin Mullins and Kevin Jarman being just two of these. I do want to say a very, very big thank you for all those who developed the program from an HEI background, from a clinical background. They have made extraordinary contributions to develop a curriculum and a perfectly shaped training package really in an incredibly short time. I think it wouldn't be right if I didn't also underscore the extraordinary contribution of the young people, the children and families who have helped make this program what it is. And I'll have a chance to say more about that in a minute, but also they will have a chance to say things throughout the morning and the day. I also want to say most of all a massive thank you for the professionals at all levels who have worked to support CYP IAPT. The contribution of CAMS managers, of supervisors, of data coordinators, as well as all the clinicians who worked on in partnerships, who were not part of the training, working together to create a new kind of CAMS community. One that's moving towards a new kind of accountability based on outcomes. And I also want to say a very personal thank you. This is actually my 35th year of paid employment. This is maybe too much detail. but it's actually the best job that I've ever had. So I want to thank everyone who has given me this opportunity, which I really could not have enjoyed more. Now, there was a courageous plan to use the IAPT initiative to radically transform child and adolescent mental health services from something that was already good to something that is actually great. Now, what does this greatness consist of? Firstly, delivering for children the best therapy which modern mental health science can offer. And doing this in relationship, in partnership with children, with young people, with families. Ensuring that what is delivered is what they needed, what they wanted, not what the profession judged to be what they needed or wanted. Alongside this, to systematically sample progress through the treatment, keeping the treatment aligned with young people, their changing ideas, their changing needs, to change method as necessary to achieve the optimal outcome, making the best possible use of data in enriching clinical supervision. This meant that supervisors needed to be trained to make best use of these new opportunities. Managers also needed training to help them transform the system to accommodate our newly trained therapists. All these individuals working in collaboration, participating in a partnership to benefit everyone who came in contact with Child and Adolescent Mental Health Services. And this, of course, gives us new opportunities to improve, analyze the information that we gather at a local level, and also to permit professions and policymakers to create a new national level data analysis. In turn, this enables us to demonstrate the true value that a high quality evidence-based service can offer. So, let me give you a brief travelogue of our journey, the journey that we've been on. The journey started in January 2011, but in fact, that was when the project team was created, but prior to that, there had been many years of campaigning by Lord Layard, David Clark, and many others in the families, the Children, Families, and Maternity Program to establish in children and young people's improved access to psychological therapies program. The team made a decision very early, to work with collaboratives of higher education institutions and child and adolescent mental health service partnerships. The HEIs became the hub of these partnerships, and the partnerships around them switched annually to be able to gradually extend to the entire country, to create an evidence-based psychological therapy movement within child and adolescent mental health services. In February, the expert reference group met for the first time and approved the global aims of our initiative, created improved access of psychological therapy service out of CAMHS. But there was a small matter not quite resolved in February 2011, how to do this. But by March of that year, three task groups began to work. A training and curriculum development group working to conjure up a new curriculum for therapists, for supervisors, and for managers. An outcomes and evaluation group working under Miranda Wolpert to provide measures for monitoring the system. And finally, a broader and evidence-based service development group to identify new methods of case management under annual. Simultaneously, we began to consult young people about what they wanted from an IAPT CAMHS service, how they thought the service should work. Now, they will speak for themselves, but their ambitions were ones which the program thoroughly embraced. So, for example, their requirement that partnerships joining collaboratives should make pledges that partnerships were then held to, is something that we've used in selecting partnerships for our program. Let me skip to last summer, which was perhaps a little bit more summary than this one. Because by June, we actually had a draft curriculum circulated. The outcomes and evaluation group produced a preliminary set of monitoring instruments that were here to actually revolutionize clinical practice, and more of this in a few moments. So we were ready to select the first collaboratives. We had 30 expressions of interest, 13 full applications. We had money for 4 collaboratives to be established. But in September, we only established 3 collaboratives. And that should indicate to you a fairly key underlying principle within IAPT, CYP, which is that only those collaboratives that could assure us of excellence in training and care delivery were selected. Remember the tight deadline. They were chosen in September. They had to start delivering training by January 2012. But before then, the supervisors needed to be trained so they could actually supervise the therapists and know what they were supposed to teach. This is just how radical CYP IAPT is. In most, that was supposed to be a joke. Obviously, it's you guys believe that we always train supervisors in advance of those who they're supposed to supervise. Moving on, in October, the Minister for Care Services launched the first year collaboratives. And in the same months, the first draft of the IAP dataset and routine outcomes monitoring measures were launched. Just in time, in fact, for November, when supervisors and service managers began training. And Cork, the CAMS Outcomes Research Collaborative, and MegaNexus were appointed to provide national data collection. In December, we paused to consult young people again. This time about how they wanted CYP IAPT to look in the year to come. And then in January, it all started. The first cohort of therapists began training. They received basic CBT training, cognitive behavior therapy training, and basic parenting training, as well as training in IAPT evidence-based case management. Then half of them received advanced CBT training or advanced parenting modules. February was an excellent month for us in a number of ways. Not only did we confirm for 2012-13 the stability of the program by advertising for next year's partnerships, but also we established the intention for permanence by setting up an accreditation steering group, specifically to accredit CYP IAPT. Then, an auspicious day, February the 29th, Paul Burstow, together with the Deputy Prime Minister, was able to announce new resources for CYP IAPT. 22 million extra over the next 3 years to pay for two new therapies, systemic family therapy, as well as interpersonal psychotherapy, and an e-learning portal to be coordinated by Ralph Calvin that would be offering e-learning for universal staff, for NHS staff, for CAMHS professionals, for counselors in schools, and counselors for young people, and perhaps to offer computerized therapies. In April 2012, we had the first upload of quarterly national CYP IAPT outcomes figures. And the second set of applications, excellent applications, were received, establishing new collaboratives. In June, interviews for new collaboratives and partnerships were held, and clinical leads for counseling and new therapies were appointed. Professor Mick Cooper was appointed as national lead for counseling, and I'm going to lead interpersonal therapy and systemic family therapy developments. And that gets us to July. Key performance indicators that you will hear about were agreed by the expert reference group. And the process to develop accreditation of courses, individuals, were agreed by the ERG. And here we are at the first IAPT conference, and the Minister for Care Services will announce today the new partnership sites and the new collaborative sites. This brings me to an excellent point to introduce the first generation of collaborative. Now, the trouble doing things for the first time is that nobody really appreciates how difficult it is. The three collaboratives, Reading with five partnerships, Manchester Salford with five partnerships, and also London, UKCL, with eight. How many people will these partnerships affect? Well, trained in the first year, we have about 120 professionals and 50 service leaders and supervisors. This should impact on about 60 to 80 localities, around 1,200 to 1,500 staff, about 2.3 million individuals. Given that the under 19 population is about 12.4 million, the percentage covered is 18.7. But what is the scientific justification for CYPIAPT? There are four key features that I will briefly touch on that have driven our project so far. Firstly, evidence-based psychological therapy practice. Secondly, routine outcomes monitoring. Thirdly, a partnership stance, listening to children and families. And lastly, improved access at various levels. I'll take each of these in turn. What is psychotherapy practice based on best evidence? Evidence-based practice is an empirically based approach to identify and appraise the best available scientific data in order to guide implementation of assessment and intervention practices. It entails decisions how to integrate scientific evidence with clinical practical considerations, settings, populations, providers, and other contextual characteristics. But research evidence is not the only base for evidence-based practice. It also takes into consideration client values and preferences, and evidence from systematically collected clinicians' real world observations, which together give quantifiable results, provide a platform for clinicians to make decisions, and ensure acceptability to recipients. This is what actually is embodied in the NICE guidance. And if you look at NICE guidance for children and young people, and you'll see that CBT, which is represented in blue, parent training in purple, counseling and supportive therapy in gray, family therapy in red, and interpersonal psychotherapy in orange, you will see that CYP IAP now pretty much covers the NICE territory. The steps of evidence-based psychotherapy practice include, initially, asking patient-centered questions about who will respond favorably to a treatment, how can adaptations be made, how can we address barriers, how can we ensure that clinically significant change is made, even in the presence of these barriers? What modifications to practice we need to ensure? How can we increase the pace of change? We need to identify and acquire the best research evidence. And that needs to be rigorous and collected systematically to our best capacities. But that needs also to be appraised critically and applied in a way that is in the best interest of the people that we serve. The context, the values and preferences of those we work with must be recognized. And finally, we have to assess outcome in an iterative manner and disseminate it as appropriate. Now, this is how we intend to deal with the horrendous gap that's between scientific knowledge and actual practice in all areas of healthcare, where the gap between best evidence and clinical practice is 17 years. It takes 17 years between scientific discovery at the bench and bedside of clinical practice. This is intolerable. This is the gap that CYP IAPT aims to bridge. But as Benjamin Franklin said, never confuse motion with action. People accept your ideas if you say that they actually were originally said by Benjamin Franklin. Anyway, I kind of can't help but recognize a certain similarity between myself and the rest of the Olympic team there from CYPI. Anyway, moving rapidly on. Bridging that gap that we hope CYP IAPT will do for us is more than dissemination and training, no matter how well training is delivered. It needs to have two drivers. At the individual level, competency drivers through selection, supervision, and coaching. And at the systems level, organizational drivers of measurement, facilitative administration, decision support system. This is where the advantage of CYP IAPT, evidence-based psychological therapies, rests. But what is the advantage of evidence-based psychological therapy? Does it improve people more than treatment as usual? Well, a number of trials find no significant difference in outcome. Overall, in meta-analysis, we now know there is a small but statistically significant difference in effectiveness. About 63% of those who have evidence-based psychotherapy are better off than usual care. But effect size is not all that matters. It's not where the action is. The guru of competition, Michael Porter, redefined healthcare in terms of value. The outcomes that matter to patients over the cost of that service. An important outcome for patients, for example, is quick recovery. Now, we know that the major benefit of evidence-based psychotherapy is not outcome, but in value. It's lower cost, 25 to 33% saving, it takes shorter time and uses less other healthcare resources, saving in education, medical services, hospital admissions, and so on. So CYP IAPT delivers greater access. It delivers greater access not simply by improving outcomes, although we would anticipate a 12 to 13% improvement overall, but improvement also in the number of individuals that we can treat, the number of children and families who are seen. Porter has shown that higher value is really cheaper care, but better care in terms of that matters most to patients. And this gets me to routine outcomes monitoring. Is that the only reason that we monitor outcomes? In mental health care, there's often an excess of data and a dramatic shortage of intelligence. If I had known that they wanted me to use all this information, I would never have asked for it. Measurement is for a purpose. There is a need for personalized care. What people frequently fail to appreciate is that evidence-based psychotherapy means personalized care. All too often, people see it as a one-size-fits-all approach. But that will, one-size-fits-all, will really lead to a dead end. There is additional benefit from the CYP IAPT protocol on top of using evidence-based psychotherapy because it avoids therapeutic dead ends. It guides us to treatment success, avoiding negative outcomes. Being able to change course in the face of a poor treatment trajectory, a poor treatment response, is what therapists actually need assistance with. A recent study from John Weiss shows this. In introducing evidence-based psychotherapies, there was a gain of 15% on treatment as usual. But there was a further gain of 18% reduction in the number of individuals who were diagnosable at the end of treatment when you used outcome measures to guide treatment decisions. That is, the total benefit is over 33%, effectively doubling the treatment effects observed. This is in addition to any cost saving delivered as part of implementing psychological therapy. So what makes these evidence-guided, outcomes-informed treatments so much more effective? Why is it so beneficial? Is it just that therapists become more effective? Perhaps yes, but there's more to it. There's more to it. In this review, I'll pretend I can accurately characterize you with a two-digit rating, and you pretend this is a meaningful process of self-reflection. We know that outcomes monitored must be meaningful to patients. And here, there may be a clue about the importance of the partnership stance. Listening to children and families is real within CYP IAPT. We made participation real, not just as part of our service delivery, but as service design and promotion. They helped young people helped specify the model, to select collaboratives, to make promotional videos, to present at conferences, to deliver the educational outcomes. And this helps us redress some of the balance. But this is not an ethical issue. There is a silent misdiagnosis that runs throughout medicine, a misdiagnosis as flawed as a bad pathology report. Doctors are really aware of preference misdiagnosis, yet treatment should be a function of medical diagnosis and preference diagnosis. This has been a particular problem in mental health. But a particular problem also for children and young people whose voices have really been heard. Nowhere as bad, perhaps, as in the context of psychological therapies. And let me end by introducing with some trepidation a bit of developmental epistemology to this audience. Why does participation matter quite so much? Well, getting comfortable in the social world is not as straightforward as you'd think. Getting to know how to be human is actually quite complicated. Being human is to do with learning about what things are about, how to do things. For example, it's not at all obvious what the true function of the object, the physical objects are that we use. Why is a spoon used for eating, not for playing drums? Luckily, humans have evolved a mechanism to teach, to learn from each other. And this is what human culture is about. Social behavior is acquired quickly and with remarkable efficiency. We learn in an extraordinary way. There is a learning superhighway that we are tuned into, that we can generalize this knowledge. But we will only do so under certain circumstances. And that circumstance is that the person teaching us has to be worthy of our epistemic trust. We have to believe them. But how do we know that we can trust them? Well, we all have experiences of learning massively from some teachers, while others who appear to have no interest in us, we learn nothing from. But this biological capacity for social learning can also be readily blocked. So it turns out the how of the teaching situation is as important as the what. And this applies, of course, to learning about ourselves in the social world as much in the context of the psychological therapies as anywhere else. In fact, most of the clients we see need our help because their capacity to change, to learn, has been deliberately blocked through their social experience. Blocked by them. They're no longer tuned in to their social world, their social learning channel. So, what can we do when this interpersonal channel for learning is tuned out? How can we open up a young person's channel of communication so that they can start learning again about how to be a person? How can we start to help open their minds to learning? What we tend to do with people who appear not to hear us is just to say it louder. Does it work? No, it just makes things worse. When there is no trust, Social learning grinds to a halt. An individual across many situations. So what we need to do is reverse this biological process about showing them that we are interested in them. And this frees the epistemic superhighway for learning. So we encourage young people's participation. We engage in monitoring of outcomes. We guide practice. We increase their access to us as agents of change. We are doing CYP IAPT. And we are also opening up their minds from a roadblock that's been closed by development. It opens up social communication and enables them to change, enables us to teach them. You do this by winning the person's trust, by showing them that you are listening to them, that you are taking their priorities, their feedback about progress seriously, by responding to them contingently, by reestablishing epistemic trust, by showing them the world is a safe place to engage with, to learn from, to communicate with. So the change that we bring about is much bigger than the simple lessons that we teach them. We are showing them that the world is there listening to them, so they should be there to listen to the world. And if this happens, then they will tune into you. My time is run out, but I just want to show you that CYP IAPT is about safeguarding the future of CAMHS, to show that we are not all dinosaurs. Thank you.